Hello guys, this is Midnight and I'm going to give you a lecture on Frankenstein. You know, Frankenstein was written by Mary Shelley. She was Mary Wollstonecraft Shelley also. Her mother was Mary Wollstonecraft, a liberal feminist philosopher, and she was also the daughter of William Godwin, a political philosopher. William Godwin was a radical political philosopher who inspired Wordsworth, Shelley, the husband of Mary Shelley, P.B. Shelley, and others. Now, both William Godwin and Mary Shelley wrote against conventional marriage, against conventional family, and this must have influenced Mary in writing about the asexual reproduction that happens in Frankenstein. Victor Frankenstein produces a so-called child, which is a monster or a creature. The background of Shelley's life, Mary Shelley's life, was suited to such an unconventional perception of marriage and reproduction. The union between William Godwin and Mary Wollstonecraft was a scandalous and celebrated relationship because of the radical lifestyles of both these people. Now, as a baby, she grew up. Mary Shelley grew up without her mother because Mary Wollstonecraft had unfortunately died in childbirth, in Mary Shelley's infancy itself. Mary Shelley was a fiercely intelligent child, jealous of attention from her father. She wanted attention from her father. And she was educated by William Godwin according to liberal political ideals. And she was also surrounded by very famous literary and intellectual people of the day, such as Coleridge, Lamb, Hazlitt, etc., who were frequent visitors at her house. Mary Shelley met her husband, Percy Bysshe Shelley, at her own house. And after their second meeting, which was 2 years after their first meeting, Mary fell in love with Percy. At that time, Mary was 17 years old. And she had a lot in common with P.B. Shelley than his own wife had at that time. So they fell in love. They had a scandalous affair. And they eloped to France. That was in the summer of 1814. It was in 1814 that Mary and Percy eloped to France. And they spent the next few years traveling around Europe and England. They returned to England in between because of poverty. During the next 5 years, Mary and Percy had a lot of troubles and traumas in their life. Mary lost three of her children and finally gave birth to a healthy son, William. That was in 1816. At the time, Shelleys were spending the summer in Switzerland, in Geneva, with Lord Byron and his doctor, John Polidori. And it is in Geneva that our Frankenstein is set. Mary was pregnant and also conceived the idea of Frankenstein, her Gothic novel, at this time. Her terrifying pregnancies that preceded this, that led to miscarriages and loss of a child, was compounded. The trauma of those pregnancies was compounded by Percy's fear that he had the venereal disease, syphilis, at this time. He believed it was treated by his surgeon, William Lawrence, successfully. And William Lawrence's knowledge of science and medicine influenced Mary Shelley in writing Frankenstein. William Lawrence was their doctor. And while the Shelleys lived in Geneva with Lord Byron and John Polidori, their conversation was full of discussions of scientific discoveries. And This also influenced Mary to write a ghost story in the manner of science fiction. And these conversations led Mary many years later to claim that they provoked in her a supremely frightful human endeavor to mock the creator of the world. She tried to mock the creator of the world, the mechanism of the creation of the world, because of these conversations and their influence. At this time, Mary and Shelley not only lived in Switzerland, they also traveled to some of the mountains in Switzerland. Remember, the Switzerland and France are the abode of the Alps mountains. These mountains where they traveled, such as Chamonix, became settings for Frankenstein. And before Frankenstein was completed, before Shelley completed writing Frankenstein, there were other tragedies in the family, such as Mary's half-sister and Shelley's first wife both committed suicide. It was in May 1817 that she completed Frankenstein. Mary Shelley was influenced by her own father, William Godwin, quite a lot. Frankenstein can be considered a Godwinian novel. Godwin had the belief that human beings are born innately good. Human beings are good and they are corrupted by the environment they grew up in. This idea is very much crucial in understanding Frankenstein's monster. Frankenstein's monster is also innately good and he turns evil because of his circumstances. Well, the idea that environment influences you is nothing new today. Today, it sounds like a commonplace idea. But in those days, in Mary Shelley's society, people were dominated by the belief in original sin. And they believed that human beings are born fallen. And they need Christ's love to redeem them to be good. So the belief in innate sinfulness was a Christian belief that was rampant at that time in the Romantic period, against which William Godwin, in a critique of religion, believed that human beings are innately good. Now, Mary Shelley was also deeply influenced by her own husband, Percy Bysshe Shelley, in writing Frankenstein, both in his romantic temperament as well as in his atheism. Shelley was a romantic, imaginative, and that romantic spirit is there deeply infused into this novel, Frankenstein. Also, Shelley's belief in atheism. Remember, Shelley famously wrote Necessity of Atheism, for which he was expelled from Oxford. And Shelley believed that poets are the unacknowledged legislators of the world. Poets are like demigods who created their own truths. So these ideas of Shelley have also influenced Mary Shelley's Frankenstein to such an extent that many people believe that the character Victor Frankenstein is modeled on Shelley. So I hope you noted all these points. Now let us go into the text itself. There are two prefaces. One published in the first edition, 1818, and another in the 1831 edition. The first one is presumably written by P.B. Shelley. In fact, in the second preface of 1831, Mary Shelley has also said that almost it was entirely written by Percy Bysshe Shelley. And the first preface of 1818 is signed Marlowe. Shelley had written a number of prose works under the pen name Hermit of Marlowe. They lived at the place Marlowe and he also took the pen name Hermit of Marlowe. The first preface by P.B. Shelley is written in a philosophical style, while the second preface by Mary is written in a conversational style. The first preface places the supernatural story of Frankenstein in the context of Darwinism and says such a story is not impossible. and he narrates how casual conversation in Geneva with friends led to the writing of this novel. Mary Shelley, however, writes a longer preface. She narrates her life from childhood up to her marriage, and she discusses the time spent at Byron's villa briefly and shows how a young girl like her could come to write such a hideous tale. She also says that the tale had finally dawned on her in a waking dream. Now, Frankenstein is subtitled The Modern Prometheus. It was published in 1818. It is called The Modern Prometheus because the character Victor Frankenstein here is like a Prometheus. He tries to give the gift of life to humanity, of creation of life to humanity, and he gets punished for it. Like Prometheus gave humanity the gift of fire and was punished for it. Mary Shelley began writing this novel in 1816. It took her 1 year to write this novel. It was completed in 1817, as I told you. At this time, she, Shelley, and Lord Byron, along with John Polidori — John Polidori, incidentally, is the grandfather of D.G. Rossetti — they all were writing ghost stories to pass the time during the summer in Switzerland. Frankenstein is partly an epistolary novel. It begins and ends with letters, and it is written in the form of a story within a story. There is a frame narrative at the beginning written in four letters. The novel documents a correspondence between Captain Robert Walton and his sister Margaret, who is called Mrs. Saville in the novel, S-A-V-I-L-L-E. This is the frame narrative. The story of Victor Frankenstein and his creature or monster is narrated by Captain Robert Walton to his sister through letters. Walton is a failed writer who sets out to explore the Arctic to attain fame. He is ambitious, he wants fame, and he sets out to explore the Arctic. During the voyage, the crew spots a dog sled driven by a gigantic man. A huge man, bigger than any human being, almost 8 feet tall, is driving a god sled in the ice. They cannot catch him or talk to him. He disappears. Later, the crew rescues a nearly frozen and emaciated man. He is very thin and dying. It turns out that his name is Victor Frankenstein. Frankenstein has been in pursuit of the gigantic man they had earlier seen. And Frankenstein starts to recover from his exertion, sees in Walton the same overambitiousness that he himself had had, and as a warning to Walton, recounts his own story. Frankenstein tells Walton his story as a warning to Walton. This is the frame narrative. Now let's go on into the novel. What I'm doing here in this video is a little tedious, but it will help you. What I'm doing is to read extracts from the book itself. I will read extracts from the book several times so that you will be able to get a feel of the book. The creature is spotted. At first, Robert Walton sees the creature. I'm reading from that section. Some of my comrades groaned, and my own mind began to grow watchful with anxious thoughts, when a strange sight suddenly attracted our attention and diverted our solicitude from our own situation. What is it that happened? We perceived a low carriage. It's a dog sled, fixed on a sledge and drawn by dogs, pass on towards the north at the distance of half a mile. A being which had the shape of a man, but apparently of gigantic stature, sat in the sledge and guided the dogs. We watched the rapid progress of the traveler with our telescopes until he was lost among the distant inequalities of the ice. This appearance excited our unqualified wonder. This is the section where he describes how they spotted the creature. Next, they are talking about how Frankenstein is found. In the morning, however, as soon as it was light, I went upon deck and found all the sailors busy on one side of the vessel, apparently talking to someone in the sea. It was in fact a sledge, like that we had seen before, which had drifted towards us in the night on a large fragment of ice. Only one dog remained alive, but there was a human being within it, whom the sailors were persuading to enter the vessel. He was not, as the other traveler seemed to be, a savage inhabitant of some undiscovered island, but a European. When I appeared on deck, the master said, "Here's our captain, and he will not allow you to perish on the open sea." I'm almost reminded of how Marlowe meets Kurtz. Now, Walton continues, "His limbs were nearly frozen, and his body dreadfully emaciated by fatigue and suffering." This is the way in which Frankenstein is found. Frankenstein finds ambition in Walton. Frankenstein himself had earlier suffered from ambition that led to disasters in his life. Now he finds the same ambition in Walton. And he says, "Unhappy man, do you share my madness? Have you drunk also of the intoxicating draught? Hear me. Let me reveal my tale, and you will dash the cup from your lips." The cup of ambition from where he has been drinking. "You seek for you seek for knowledge and wisdom as I once did. And I ardently hope that the gratification of your wishes may not be a serpent to sting you as mine has been. When I tried to gratify my wishes, to fulfill my ambition, it was like embracing a serpent that would sting me. I do not know that the relation of my disasters will be useful to you." Relation means narration. "Yet, when I reflect that you are pursuing the same course, exposing yourself to the same dangers which have rendered me what I am, I imagine that you may deduce an apt moral from my tale. One that may direct you if you succeed in your undertaking and console you in case of failure." So he's telling his own tale. Frankenstein is telling his own tale so that Walton may learn from it. Victor's childhood. Don't worry, it is not going to be reading from the book entirely, but you need to read the book along with me to get a taste of Mary Shelley's style. Victor's childhood was absolutely beautiful. Victor's childhood was absolutely happy. His father was Alphonse, a public official, and his mother was Carolyn. They were ideal parents. Look at what Victor says. "From Italy, they visited Germany and France. I, their eldest child, was born at Naples, and as an infant accompanied them in their rambles. I remained for several years their only child. Much as they were attached to each other, They seemed to draw inexhaustible stores of affection from a very mine of love to bestow them upon me. My mother's tender caresses and my father's smile of benevolent pleasure while regarding me are my first recollections. I was their plaything and their idol, and something better, their child, the innocent and helpless creature bestowed on them by heaven, whom to bring up to good, and whose future lot it was in their hands to direct to happiness or misery, according as they fulfilled their duties towards me. I was their only child for a long time. Much later, William was born, and they also had adopted children. I was innocent, helpless, and they bestowed all their duties upon me to direct me to happiness. One day, when my father had gone by himself to Milan, my mother, accompanied by me, visited this abode. She found a peasant and his wife, hardworking, bent down by care and labor, distributing a scanty meal to five hungry babes. The mother, Carolyn, is coming upon a peasant family with five hungry children. Among these, there was one which attracted my mother far above all the rest. She appeared of a different stock. The four others were dark-eyed, hardy little vagrants. This child was thin and very fair. Now, that is something that attracts our deconstruction. This is Elizabeth, a child that the family is going to adopt. And Mary Shelley is describing the appearance of Elizabeth as fair and beautiful compared to her siblings. She seems to draw our attention to the prejudices of the wealthy people of her society. Now, the mother likes Elizabeth because she is beautiful. And later on, we realize this beauty of Elizabeth that is described many, many times is in opposition to the hideous ugliness of the monster. There is a dichotomy emerging here. There are many opposites like this in Mary Shelley's writing. One dichotomy or opposite emerging here is Elizabeth versus the monster. Her hair was the brightest living gold, and despite the poverty of her clothing, seemed to set a crown of distinction on her head. Her brow was clear and ample, her blue eyes cloudless, and her lips and the molding of her face so expressive of sensibility and sweetness that none could behold her without looking on her as of a distinct species, a being heaven-sent and bearing a celestial stamp in all her features. If Elizabeth is described in an overly excited manner as extremely beautiful, the monster will be described later as extremely hideous. This is a technique or strategy that Mary Shelley is employing. Victor gets Elizabeth. On the evening previous to her being brought to my home, my mother had said playfully, "I have a pretty present for my Victor. Tomorrow he shall have it." And when on the morrow she presented Elizabeth to me as her promised gift, I, with childish seriousness, interpreted her words literally and looked upon Elizabeth as mine to protect, love, and cherish. It should be noted here that Victor's mother teaches Victor to look upon people and relationships as objects or presence. And when Victor makes the monster, he does not realize that the monster has a soul or a mind, that the monster has feelings. Almost like Henry Higgins in Pygmalion doesn't realize that Eliza has feelings. And he looks upon the monster as a thing that he has created. He never, except in very rare occasions, feels compassion for the monster. This is a feeling that he has grown up with since the time he got Elizabeth. Victor's closest friend is Henry Clerval, with whom he grows up. Henry and Victor are opposites. Henry Clerval is philosophical and moral. Victor is not. Victor, on the other hand, is obsessed with solving the mysteries of life, more like a scientist. This was a reaction to his father's revulsion at the alchemists. When Victor was 13 years old, he had been reading Agrippa. He discovered the works of Agrippa, an alchemist, and he was reading them voraciously. And the father dismissed Agrippa without explanation, without telling him why. And Victor was like shocked. Victor grew up with the fear of his intellectual choices. So his turning towards science and practical aspects was a reaction to his father's revulsion at the alchemists. Victor and Clerval are thus opposites. Victor started reading and penetrating deeper into knowledge, and he got interested finally in the science of life. How is life created? How do people die? Things like that. As I told you, when he was 13, he was fascinated by Agrippa's work, which his father just dismissed as sad trash without any explanation. Neither did the father, what is his name? Alphonse. Neither did he introduce Victor to modern science. So by this incident, Victor is deeply affected and was never again intellectually honest with his father. He never told his father that he's trying to create this monster. He never disclosed to anyone. He hid his knowledge and his experiment from everybody. Frankenstein's academic interest. Under the guidance of his new preceptors, I entered with the greatest diligence into the search of the philosopher's stone and the elixir of life. But the latter, elixir of life, what gives people life, that soon obtained my undivided attention. Victor, you should remember, you should understand, was not after wealth. Wealth was an inferior object. But what was he after? He was after glory. But what glory would attend the discovery if I could banish disease from the human frame and render man invulnerable to any but a violent death? He wanted to experiment with man's body and existence. He wanted to banish disease and get the glory of such an experiment. Before this, I was not unacquainted with the more obvious laws of electricity. He already knew about electricity and its laws even before this. On this occasion, a man of great research in natural philosophy was with us. He had a mentor. He had a teacher from whom he learned natural philosophy and about electricity. And excited by this catastrophe, he entered on the explanation of a theory which he had formed on the subject of electricity and galvanism. Galvanism is the theory that by applying electric shock to inanimate matter, you can bring life into it. So there is a man who discusses galvanism and electricity with Victor, and he becomes completely absorbed in this subject. He begins to read on this subject and experiment with this subject. It was at once new and astonishing to me. Victor's parents urge him to study further to move on from Geneva and go to the University of Ingolstadt. Before he leaves for Ingolstadt, like an ill omen, you know what happens? Elizabeth falls ill with scarlet fever. His mother, Caroline, nurses her Elizabeth. Elizabeth is saved, but his mother dies. Her dying wish is that they marry. Elizabeth and Victor should marry. Victor reaches Ingolstadt and his teacher dismisses his former mystical learning of Alchemist and Agrippa and asks him to start anew based on modern science. The teacher at Ingolstadt completely dismisses whatever Victor had learned until then. And then Victor finds an inspiring teacher in Monsieur Waldman. There is one Waldman who inspires Victor. Inspired by Waldman, like a wild romantic, Victor is obsessed with the desire to explore unknown powers of creation. He doesn't act like a scientist. He is not dominated by reason. He is dominated by emotion and the excitement at knowing the irrational and the unknown. Here, Victor is more like a romantic poet than a scientist. At Ingolstadt, Victor plunges into the study of natural philosophy and physiology. And he studies the science of death and decay of the human body. And without any elaborate drama, Victor very quickly tells us that he discovered the astonishing secret of life. He does not elaborate upon it. After days and nights of incredible labor and fatigue, I'm reading from the book, I succeeded in discovering the cause of generation and life. Nay, more, I became myself capable of bestowing animation upon lifeless matter. He must have experimented with small animals that are dead, and at one point he brought life into these animals, into inanimate dead bodies. He's not explaining that. And then he goes on to say, although I possessed the capacity of bestowing animation, yet to prepare a frame for the reception of it, he has to make a body first, to prepare a frame for the reception of it, with all its intricacies of fibers, muscles, and veins, still remained a work of inconceivable difficulty and labor. It was not at all easy. I doubted at first whether I should attempt the creation of a being like myself or one of simpler organization, but my imagination was too much exalted by my first success of bringing animation upon lifeless matter. That first success was such an encouragement to permit me to doubt my ability to give life to an animal as complex and wonderful as man. He wanted to create something like a man, and he was ready for it. He wanted to do it. So, with a lot of confidence, he set out to do it. Victor finally makes a monster. How does he do that? Although I possessed the capacity of bestowing animation. I already read this. I wrongly repeated it. Let me read it again. Although I possessed the capacity of bestowing animation, yet to prepare a frame for the reception of it, with all its intricacies of fibers, muscles, and veins, still remained a work of inconceivable difficulty and labor. I doubted at first whether I should attempt the creation of a being like myself or one of simpler organization, but my imagination was too much exalted by my first success to permit me to doubt of my ability to give life to an animal as complex and wonderful as man. In this passage, you understand that what matters to Frankenstein is speed and practicality, not aesthetics or morality. He is never bothered about the morality of what he is doing or the aesthetics of what he is doing. I can safely delete this. You can also join me in editing this. I can increase the size a little bit and I can also add some more line spacing. There we go. So, Victor makes a monster merely out of his desire for practicality and speed. He does not consider or care for beauty or morality. And now, why did Victor do it? In exams, you might be asked questions like this. Victor Frankenstein created a monster in this manner. They will give a paragraph. Which of the following correctly describes his motivation in doing it? It can be an objective type question or a descriptive type question. Victor himself says, "No one can conceive the variety of feelings which bore me onwards, like a hurricane in the first enthusiasm of success." When he got success in bringing animation upon lifeless matter for the first time, no one can imagine the variety of feelings that he had, like in Satan in Paradise Lost, getting a flurry of emotions and thoughts before he tempts man. Frankenstein gets a lot of confusing thoughts and ideas before he creates the monster. Like the original fall, this creation of Frankenstein is a momentous mistake, is a big mistake that he makes that has far-reaching implications. It is analogous to the original sin. So, Frankenstein continues, "Life and death appeared to me ideal bounds, which I should first break through and pour a torrent of life into our dark world." Life and death bring darkness in this world. He wanted to bring light into this world by creating life. Nobody will have to fear death now. "A new species would bless me as its creator and source." Look at his ambition. He wants to be known as the creator of a new species. "Many happy and excellent natures would owe their being to me." This is like Eve's expectations when she is eating the fruit. Alas, little does she know what the real consequences would be. Like that, Victor is like Eve. Victor is like Satan. Victor is like God also, because he is creating. "No father could claim the gratitude of his child so completely as I should deserve theirs. Pursuing these reflections, I thought that if I could bestow animation upon lifeless matter, I might in process of time, though I now found it impossible, renew life where death had apparently devoted the body to corruption." Normally, life leads to death through corruption, decay. But he is hoping that he will be able to conquer death. Victor undergoes great stress and takes a great effort to make the creature. It is not easy. He undergoes great stress. "I collected bones from charnel houses and disturbed with profane fingers the tremendous secrets of the human frame. In a solitary chamber, or rather cell at the top of his house," he is describing a godforsaken attic in his house. That is where he did it. "And separated from all the other apartments by a gallery and staircase, I kept my workshop of filthy creation." That's a very famous phrase. He is calling his creation of the monster filthy creation. "My eyeballs were starting from their sockets in attending to the details of my employment." He had to do it with such meticulous detail, with such careful effort, that his eyeballs were starting from their sockets, falling off. "The dissecting room and the slaughterhouse furnished many of my materials, and often did my human nature turn with loathing from my occupation. He was disgusted at what he is doing, whilst still urged on by an eagerness which perpetually increased, I brought my work near to a conclusion." It was with a lot of divide in his mind, division in his mind, dilemma that he is doing it. Finally, on a dreary November night, remember the time, it is a dreary November night, it is winter, the creature opened its dull yellow eyes. They are not bright eyes, dull yellow eyes. I am quoting from the book. Look at Frankenstein's monster from a 1931 film. The film commemorated the centenary of the 1831 edition, or the second edition. This is Frankenstein's monster from a 1994 film, Robert De Niro. And after Victor sees the monster created and alive, Victor is thoroughly disgusted. The different accidents of life are not so changeable as the feelings of human nature. He is saying human nature is, or feelings, human feelings are so changeable. You will be excited about something and happy about something at one moment. Immediately, soon after, you might also feel disgusted with it. He says, I had worked hard for nearly 2 years for the sole purpose of infusing life into an inanimate body. For this, I had deprived myself of rest and health. I had desired it with an ardor that far exceeded moderation. But now that I had finished, the beauty of the dream vanished. The breathless horror and disgust filled my heart. Unable to endure the aspect of the being I had created, he is unable to endure the sight of the monster. What did he do? I rushed out of the room and continued a long time traversing my bedchamber. He kept pacing up and down in his bedchamber, unable to compose my mind to sleep. It was night. He cannot sleep and he doesn't know what to do. Finally, Victor manages to sleep. And in his mind, in his dream, he sees beautiful Elizabeth. He embraces and kisses her. And suddenly she turns into his mother's corpse in his arms. This dreadful nightmare with which he wakes up is actually an indication of his Oedipal urge to possess his mother, to kiss his mother, which will actually only lead to disaster and death. Remember, Mary Shelley is writing this many years before Sigmund Freud talked about the Oedipal complex. And also, in creating the monster, Victor has a desire to be the mother. But that is a thwarted desire. Because his desire to be the mother ends in disgust and disappointment. This dream is also a heightened mood, presents a heightened mood of sexual horror and disgust. It is a disgust at the human body, at the body that he has created. It is a disgust at reproduction. Probably what Mary Shelley felt because of her traumatic pregnancies. Victor now wakes up and sees the monster forcing its way out of the window shutters. Victor then abandons the creature and goes away. He cannot stay in that house. It is only the next day that he returns. And he is with Henry Clerval. He makes Clerval wait outside. And inside the house, to his joy, he found that the monster had left. There is no monster in the house. He is overjoyed at being freed of his responsibility of his action. He does not want to take his responsibility. He's happy that the monster has left and he doesn't worry about what will happen to the monster or what the monster will do to others. He doesn't care about how the monster will survive. Like Raskolnikov, after that terrible act of murder that he committed, falls into a feverish state, that is in Crime and Punishment. After committing a murder, Raskolnikov falls into a feverish state. Like that, here, Victor, ironically, commits a creation, not murder, but which is actually like a murder. It was a murder of his humanness. He's trying to be like God. He's overstretching himself. And after that horrendous act that he has done, Victor also, like Raskolnikov, falls into a feverish state. It is Henry Clerval who nurses him back to life. 2 years pass. Victor doesn't know what has happened to the monster. As Victor decides to leave Ingolstadt and go home to Geneva, he gets a letter from his father, Alphonse, which informs him that his younger brother, William, has been strangled to death. And Victor comes home. He sees that William's body has black marks of fingers on his neck. And William's body was discovered by Justine Moritz, a kind, gentle girl who had been adopted by the Frankenstein household. Justine Moritz is accused because she found the body. She is tried, condemned, and executed despite her assertions of innocence. Can you believe that? A little girl is executed for this murder. And this incident that Mary Shelley is describing is not about the monster or any of the concerns that were dealt with till now. This incident is about injustice in the society. It is a highly unjust trial. It is a highly unequal society. And remember, Mary Shelley's husband, P.B. Shelley, was an ardent revolutionary. He fought for equality and people's rights. This is the time after the French Revolution also. So Mary Shelley is making an indictment of an unjust legal system, an unjust society in this incident. Remember, there are two children who have died here, William and Justine. Victor spots the monster in the wilderness of the Alps and guiltily realizes that his creation is the reason for these two deaths of his loved ones. From this moment onwards, Victor lives in guilt. Victor is horrified that it is his act of creation, his experiment, that has led to the murder of these people. And he doesn't know how many more will die now. The death of children should also be related to Mary Shelley's loss of children, her pregnancies and miscarriages and the death of a child. Let me read about the first death. While I watched the tempest, so beautiful and terrific. Remember, throughout the novel, nature plays a vital role. Based on what is happening in the book, nature also throws up storms and rains many, many times. It is a tempestuous climate that is depicted in this novel. While I watched the tempest, so beautiful and terrific, I wandered on with a hasty step. This noble war in the sky elevated my spirits. I clasped my hands and exclaimed aloud, William, dear angel, this is thy funeral, this is thy dirge. The storm is William's dirge or funeral song. As I said these words, I perceived in the gloom a figure which stole from behind a clump of trees near me. I stood fixed, gazing intently. I could not be mistaken. A flash of lightning illuminated the object and discovered its shape plainly to me. He's calling the monster an object. Its gigantic stature and the deformity of its aspect more hideous than belongs to humanity. He is describing the monster, his own creation. It was his choice to make the monster with such ugliness. It is not the monster's fault. And now he is describing it as more hideous than anything that belongs to humanity. It instantly informed me that it was the wretch, the filthy demon to whom I had given life. What did he there? 2 years, and again later he says, 2 years had now nearly elapsed since the night on which he first received life. And was this his first crime? Alas, I had turned loose into the world a depraved wretch whose delight was in carnage and misery. Had he not murdered my brother? He is lamenting that his own creation has turned out into a depraved wretch whose delight was in carnage and misery. Never does he hold himself responsible for this downfall of the monster. He is speaking as if the monster was by birth a wretch. He never liked the monster. He never holds himself responsible for the monster's downfall. He only holds himself responsible for creating the monster. He doesn't realize that if only he had given the monster some love, some help, some care, he wouldn't have killed anybody. The monster is actually good at heart, which we will come to realize later. And at this time, Elizabeth is a great support to Victor. And Elizabeth's character has bloomed. She is more mature and deep compared to Victor himself. Elizabeth says, "When I reflect, my dear cousin, on the miserable death of Justin Moritz, I no longer see the world and its works as they before appeared to me." This is a very philosophical discussion of the situation that she's giving. When she thinks about the miserable death of Justin Moritz, she understands how unjust the world is. That is what she's saying. "Before, I looked upon the accounts of vice and injustice that I read in books or heard from others as tales of ancient days or imaginary evils." She never realized that such injustice and vice would be there in her society. At least they were remote and more familiar to reason than to the imagination. But now misery has come home. She realizes that such injustice and vice is there right at home, right there in her society. "And men appear to me as monsters thirsting for each other's blood." This is a very important speech, because the monster is more human and the humans are more like monsters. I am reminded of Gulliver's Travels, where horses are more human and humans are more like animals. In the fourth book of Gulliver's Travels, Elizabeth is the voice of reason in this book. Elizabeth says, "Men appear to me as monsters thirsting for each other's blood." While the crime done by the monster is actually forgivable, because it was a reaction to his own rejection and desolation in life. I hope you understand. "Now, William and Justine were assassinated," continues Elizabeth, "and the murderer escapes. He walks about the world free and perhaps respected." How true, even today, when you think of political murders, when you think of how powerful people do away with their enemies, it is still the same. Sometimes innocent people have to suffer, they have to die, and the murderer escapes. He walks about the world free and perhaps respected. We have seen situations where such murderers become powerful rulers also. Now, Victor meets the creature in the Alps. Victor is at home. He is spending some time in the mountains. Victor takes a vacation in the Alps and meets the monster at the village of Chamonix in France. Village of Chamonix. Victor sees the monster. He verbally abuses him as devil and vile insect because he's angry that the monster killed his brother. And then the monster speaks. The monster speaks. You never heard the monster speak before. I expected this reception, said the demon. All men hate the wretched. How then must I be hated, who am miserable beyond all living things? People who are miserable are hated by others. I am more miserable than any living thing, so I must be hated most. That is what the monster is saying. Yet you, my creator, detest and spurn me, thy creature. Oh, this is also again biblical. I am reminded of Satan in Milton. How Satan, in his soliloquy, is upset, torn apart, because his father has done this to him. Yet you, my creator, detest and spurn me, thy creature, to whom thou art bound by ties, only dissoluble by the annihilation of one of us. This relationship between the creator and the creature, this hatred between them, will end only with the annihilation of one of us. You purpose to kill me. The purpose of Victor Frankenstein is to kill the monster. How dare you sport thus with life? Oh, this is a very important question. The connection with Paradise Lost is very, very deep-rooted. There are many quotations from Paradise Lost also in this novel. How dare you sport thus with life? The epigraph of Frankenstein is also, why did you make me God? I will read it later. How dare you sport thus with life? Do your duty towards me, says the creature to the creator. I will do mine towards you and the rest of mankind. If you will comply with my conditions, I will leave them and you at peace. But if you refuse, I will glut the maw of death until it be satiated with the blood of your remaining friends. The creature is like Satan, taking revenge upon his creator. Mary Shelley is talking from the point of view of the creature, like Milton talked from the point of view of Satan. The creature is presented like a Rousseauian noble savage. He admits to the murder of William, but begs for understanding, as you heard in this passage. He also begs Victor to listen to his story. Now, the creature is going to tell his story. I will continue with that in another video. You can take a break.